August 1st, 2017. This is the Central Business Architecture Committee meeting. We have two items on the agenda today. Reviewing 256 Pleasant Street, the lumberyard, which is not public comment?
It's not officially a public hearing. They have to come back and present their, how they address the conditions in the plan.
Okay, and then we're also reviewing the exterior ramp addition by the City of Northampton for the Academy of Music at 274 Main Street, Northampton, map ID 31D-166. And we'll open the meeting with any comment, public comment on any items that are not on the agenda. Is there anyone here to make public comment on anything that's not on the agenda? Then we're going to start with reviewing the modifications to 256 Pleasant Street. And there are a few items. This is their final review, and they're just coming back to show us their final drawings and showing us some additional information that was requested. So please introduce yourself.
Sure.
And
Joanne Campbell, Executive
Excuse
Director.
Me one second. I'm Bridget Goggins. I need to recuse myself.
Okay. Joanne Campbell, Executive Director of Valley Community Development Corporation. We were here in November of 2014, received our CBAC approval in January of 2015. We had a number of conditions that we need to address before we are ready to file for a building permit. So we have assembled all our financing. We are moving toward closing on that financing, which of course includes needing a building permit, and we hope to be in the ground sometime in the late fall. So I'm going to ask Bob Williamson from Davis Square Architects, who is the architect on the project, the original architect, is, to sort of go through the conditions, and then obviously you can ask some questions. And also with us is Laura Baker, who's our real estate project manager.
Hi. Hi, I'm Bob with Davis Square Architects. So one of the most important things that we dealt with was just continuing the exterior design, and as we developed the job into construction documents to get a price and get it signed on with the contractor to make sure that everything remained consistent and in, you know, concurred with the original elevations that were approved and planned as well. So I know some of the most important items were the cornice lines and the brickwork on the two bookends of the L shape of the building. And so our goal was to detail and develop them into final construction documents that were concurrent with the original design intent. All of the windows remain the 2-over-1 double hung type, and we ensure that the commercial and office space layout remained in the same locations with pretty much the same square footage, you know, plus or minus a couple square feet as you turn into real construction documents. It's important that the awnings and storefront details remain true to the original intent. One of the things we wanted to point out was that the sign band material will be a three-part stucco, not a metal. And below it will be metal awnings with a wood ceiling. So they won't be they'll be a permanent part of the building and not a canvas awning that would, you know, eventually fade and need replacement. And we made sure that we got in the recessed bump in recessed entryway at the commercial space.
Excuse me, so, I'm just sorry.
No problem.
Are you going to point this out to us on the plans? Because just hearing verbally, it's hard to picture what you're talking about.
Absolutely.
On these.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so you can just come up and.
Oh, we're right here. I mean, you,
that's fine by me.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're going to a lot of
things,
and it's hard to
that.
pull them out, so.
Used to like a side projector or something.
Yeah, we gotta do that, but absolutely.
Do you guys have a copy of what these conditions were on the decision that were?
Yes.
Okay.
So why don't we back up and start?
Let's back up with.
Yeah.
The cornice.
Cornice, yeah.
And so for those of you that don't have it printed out, the first item was elevation showing the continuation of the mid cornice to the front of the building and the final cornice details.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe you could talk about that.
So I would say this would be the mid cornice you're referencing.
Okay.
Yeah. So that's very similar to the detailing of the upper cornice. And so those we're matching, and then the.
What materials are you using for the cornice? So the masonry?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's a red brick.
Yeah.
With cast stone headers and.
Yeah, so that's right.
But this will all be great.
Right.
So there's detail pages after that. So I guess we can.
You had also mentioned the canopy. Is that what, this was what you were discussing here?
Nope. That is the kind of courtyard canopy.
Right.
The canopies I was referencing to are these elements.
Three-part stucco.
Yeah, with the stucco.
So the stucco is signed in. So we're jumping ahead to some of the other items.
Oh, yeah.
I guess if we could just go through them one by one,
yeah.
And then we can sort of check them off.
Well, you mentioned earlier.
Yep. So I just to comment on that first item, I think part of what we were looking at previously is that the cornice continuation wasn't complete, we felt, when it first came through. And I think that these elevations do show that they've capped sort of the ends of the cornices, and they've continued that mid cornice through, which I think, and forgive me, it's been 2 years since I looked at this, but it seemed like there were gaps in the previous design, which was more of a schematic or design development level set of drawings, and this is a more complete cohesive. So in my opinion, and you all can comment obviously, I think that they've met the requirements of showing the continuation of both the mid cornice and the cornice details at the top of the building. Anyone have any comments on that item? So the second one, the location of one, so I think there's a little bit of the way that this is phrased is not quite correct. It says the location of one required 36-inch recessed entryway. I believe what guideline seven says is one entryway every 40 feet recessed 36 inches.
Okay.
So we can look at that on the plans perhaps.
The original plans didn't have any recessed entryways.
Exactly, which didn't meet the guidelines.
One has been added on Pleasant Street side.
Yeah, so I think they were meaning to have one entrance on Pleasant Street, so I think that's why it's listed this way, that we wanted at least the one to be 36 recess.
Facing the street.
Yeah.
Yeah.
A100.
And it looks like the other door that's facing Pleasant Street has a ramp associated
on
with
it? On the inside.
On the inside.
Yeah.
And that's because of the elevation change on the sidewalk?
Exactly. And basically, we're not sure if this is going to be one tenant or two tenants, you know, separating down the middle, and that's why we wanted to maintain the two entrances. And as always, they have the original schematic that I was working on to match. This one was not recessed.
Mm-hmm.
They were both in the main plane of the storefront. So I just wanted to make sure that we kept the same amount of doors that was in the original design, but.
So you could have potentially two tenants?
Yes.
That's why there's two doors?
Yeah.
So this is a recessed entry.
Yep.
In this entry, it ramps up in here?
Ramps down just a couple inches.
So the sidewalk goes
yeah.
up.
Oh, okay. I see. All right. So both of these are at grade, the
yeah.
doors. It's not
yeah,
a step
it
ramps
down 3 inches.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So do you think by the guidelines of this, second amendment should be reset?
Well, let me read it, what it actually says. So theme or anomaly, street facades should have at least one doorway every 40 feet recessed at least 36 inches from the sidewalk. Now, I think the intent of that is on a narrow sidewalk. They don't want the doors swinging out into people walking on the sidewalk. But this facade kind of curves away, and I believe in the site plan that it's a generous sidewalk. So it's not, it's quite, you can see in the site plan here.
Yeah.
You know, here's the recess door and the other one is over here. So I don't think that there's an issue of somebody walking into a door as someone's walking out of the building. So that's what I think the intent of that guideline is for.
Right.
And to me, they're meeting it by providing the one recessed.
Yeah, I don't have a problem.
The final height of the bulkhead detail, and I think this is the storefront detail, the base of the storefront or the bulkhead of the storefront.
Mm-hmm.
What the final height of it is, and the guideline again is to be between 12 inches and 30 inches.
Okay.
And while there isn't an exact detail of that in the drawings that we were given, if you run the elevations across, it looks like it's about 24 inches plus.
Is it this lower span?
Yep.
And that's 2 feet.
So again, that appears to meet the guideline.
What are those bulkheads?
They'll be part of the storefront system, but a solid panel instead of glass.
The sign band material, which you already mentioned, is a cementitious three-part stucco. Mm-hmm. So I think that's fine.
That's above these awnings.
Exactly.
Right here, right?
Exactly.
The awnings are still awnings, so they're still fabric awnings?
They're metal. Standing seam metal.
Okay.
Sheet metal sides to go with the standing seam and then a wood seam.
Those would be nice. Extent of the horizontal banding above the first floor. And you can describe that. I have a guess of what that is.
Okay. Was that related to the these awnings and cementitious like sign material, or is I took that as just the overall banding of that. So essentially,
this is 2 years ago,
yeah.
But I think some of the elevations that we saw had variation in colors of brick, which created horizontal bands.
Oh,
and I think that was not something we were particularly thrilled with.
So that is completely gone.
Okay.
It's just one color of brick, and you can see in the elevations, I guess this is a good one. These are all 2 inches proud or in front of this, the brick in between the windows.
Mm-hmm.
So this is all just one color of brick all the way up to the parapet, up until the cap. So there's no banding of two different types of brick.
I noticed, I don't know if this is relevant now, but it's that brick using modular brick veneer. So those are modular sections. They're not veneer brick laid out.
Oh, no. Just the modular size, meaning just standard size brick.
Oh, but they're regular. They're mortar-laid brick.
Mortar-laid.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I didn't like prefab.
Nope.
Okay.
No.
Right. All right.
That's for the contractor, so they know exactly the size. Yeah.
Is there any banding in the the fiber cement plank siding? It seems like it, there is.
Oh, no, the fiber cement plank siding will be one color, and the fiber cement panels above will be another solid color. So
okay.
no change in coursing of the fiber cement, or and no change in color.
Okay. Your drawings, and maybe it's just the way it printed, mm-hmm. it appeared like there were three bands.
I think it was just the four lines you showed there.
Oh, yeah.
Let's see.
Yes, I see what you mean. Yep.
Here.
That's that particular
printer.
Okay. Yeah.
This panel, so these are cementitious panels
yep.
up here. What's the seam detail?
That is an aluminum trim cap
okay.
that will be the same color as the
G molded or H molded.
Exactly, it's the H molded, yeah. But the intent is for those to blend in, to fade, not really express themselves.
Is everyone satisfied with the horizontal banding above the first panel?
Yeah, actually, I didn't know I thought that meant, like the extent of the awnings and how far they go, because when the whole brick banding was gone by the time I was working on this, so I'm a little confused, but I think that makes sense now. Yeah.
That's what I recall, but again, it was a long time ago, so. I'm actually surprised that I remembered. The last item is the final layout of the canopy above
mm-hmm.
the first floor, which I think is what you've been talking about, is
mm-hmm.
the metal canopies and wood. I think originally they were called out as fabric, which we were concerned about.
Yeah.
So I think the detail that's being described is a nice detail.
Yeah, there's paint in there.
Just as an aside, where's the front elevation of this section now?
Here. So
A201.
No, I just, it's again, we did this twice, and I remember the original one, the upper corners had like openings.
Right.
No,
those were
both. Oh,
yeah. It was a few meetings. So.
Yeah. And yeah, now it's it's those little squares there, those are just another little half-inch recess of brick.
Like, the yeah.
Yeah, so this is 2 inches set
right.
back, and then that's just another half inch.
Right. Yeah. So that still hides the mechanicals behind
yeah.
it.
Yeah, right.
Except for the elevator house.
The one last item, which actually is identified as item one, notes prior to issuance of the building permit, final design for the interior courtyard canopy shall be approved by the committee. And I think at the time there weren't really details of what it was. It was just really a line on a piece of paper.
Yeah.
And maybe you could describe that a little bit, because
okay.
Not everybody is an architect here or can read details.
Yeah. So if you jump to A509, if you want to have it. So the shape remains the same in terms of its gesture that was just outlined. But the idea is to have four columns on a slight angle from the building that are reclaimed from one of the lumberyard structures, about 8x8, and they will support a steel frame structure that supports a call wall canopy, which is a translucent fiberglass panel that will be sloped towards the building, and we'll have a gutter system and downspouts with cast iron boots tied into the stormwater system to provide, a nice, as you're walking along Pleasant Street and there's the public alley or secondary entrance, or I guess you could call it a primary entrance as well, to the building, there's a really attractive and interesting element to bring you in. And so starting from the ground, we'll have, you know, the unit pavers for the whole courtyard area and benches and whatnot. And then the wood posts will be held off the ground with a little steel cruciform or T-shaped structure, and that will also be used to connect to the steel I-beam structure that supports the overall panel system. It's not cheap.
But those, yeah, but the wood, these are 8x8 recycled wood column.
Yeah.
But they basically go right to grade, right to the
Yeah,
the
wood stops there, and then that's the
oh,
steel,
that's
the steel stand up there. Yeah.
Oh, okay. All right, so they're kind of pocketed into that, so
exactly.
That the surface is almost flush between the metal and the...
Yeah, yeah, the metal, so the metal has a little knife edge coming out into it. Yeah.
There is you can kind of see in a very small elevation of it right there.
Yep.
Can you see that?
Yeah.
No, I saw it on the video one. Yeah.
There's a perspective drawing where you're kind of looking in.
Oh, yeah.
Part of the building.
Yeah.
And see
it's not an aesthetic question. I'm just curious, the cow wall in that relatively horizontal position,
mm-hmm.
doesn't that sag a little bit over time with those panels? They're not that thick, those panels.
No, These will be the 2 3/4 inches thick, but they're 2 3/4 thick. Yeah.
Oh, so they have like a
they
cell
have,
them?
Yeah, they have, oh. I think they have like an aluminum vertical bar.
Oh, okay.
In them.
Yeah. I was thinking of
yeah.
different material.
Okay. Yeah, they have their own engineering people there that I talked to and gave them specs from our engineer on the loads and the uplift from the wind. So they got that all taken care of.
I think it's a kind of a cool detail, a little piece of modern architecture, and it's set back. It's not right on the main street, so I think it'll be a nice feature. I would recommend when you come before a committee that's not made up of architects that you bring a close-up 3D image of that kind of detail in the future. But.
Okay, well then, thank you.
But otherwise, I think that covers all of the items.
There was a comment about mechanicals not being seen from the street places.
Oh, there was a comment about that, but it's not on here. So, but you can go ahead and describe that.
It's in our current. There's some perspectives.
A500?
Yeah.
Do you have a page?
Yeah.
And this little floor plan here, just keys where I'm taking these sections.
Yeah.
So essentially the idea is to have a big section. So if you're standing at a Northampton Coffee across the street, and you're looking up and that's your sight line.
These are all mechanical units up here.
How tall are those units?
Between 3 and 4 feet.
What are all these? Like, what are these? Like split units?
Each in it's a in these kind of buildings. The mechanical systems, the central systems, are getting extremely.
Oh no, I understand completely.
Yeah, and so this is the most affordable option.
No, I'm a builder. I understand.
Oh, okay.
I'm surprised that that's the way to
do it. Yeah, that's.
But you're seeing. So this sight line, though, these aren't exposed from any angle at all. They get hidden pretty much.
If you're across the street from the building, from either Holyoke or Pleasant Street. Made sure that they weren't visible. We tucked them back in the roof plan.
You can kind of see from how they're tucked back on the edge of.
Right.
Yeah.
We originally had them.
That elevation is deceiving. Because
exactly. That's funny. Yeah. Yeah. And we had them in little groups of 8 at first, and that wasn't working. And made sure that the ERVs, the larger units, package units, were tucked into this corner, so that you wouldn't see them.
It's unfortunate. The elevator house, so.
That's what's hiding the other stuff. It could be worse.
It's not very pretty. Unless you like cubes.
not a cell tower.
What?
It's not a cell tower.
Or a solar roof going.
That technically wasn't an item on our, on this, what we were issued, but I know it was something.
It was in the decision, but it wasn't the thing that had to be, it was just, you can't see it, so it wasn't in the list of things they had to bring back for you.
It shows up in our planning decisions.
Yeah.
Sure. That is good.
If everyone agrees that they've met the requirements that we requested, could I get a motion for someone to accept the drawings as presented?
I'll make a motion to accept the drawings as presented.
Give me a second.
Second?
Favor.
All three of us?
Yeah.
That's so far.
Thank you, good luck.
Good luck.
Thank you.
Looking forward to it.
See you on the ground.
Just push that down in the town.
You guys, you'll start construction.
I guess.
All right.
The.
Sure.
Probably some mobilization for some infrastructure work, so.
Is that, yeah, I'm not.
It's all involved in the large.
What's that?
The plan, the wrong one.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, yeah.
That whole thing.
Yeah, one.
That was my concern on building.
I'm all set.
Yeah. I feel like they've scaled it down quite a bit.
Because thinking about building something, you know, like 20 feet high above it.
We can construct.
Right.
We can see.
We are now going to move on to our second presentation, which is review the exterior ramp petition by City of Northampton for the Academy of Music, 274 Main Street, map ID 31D-166.
My name's Tom Douglas. The reason we're doing this project is because there's no accessible route to the stage house at the Academy. And we've gradually been making the theater more and more accessible. So this is just the next phase of that. So this is the side elevation, South Street. These are the new fire escapes that we did a couple of years ago. And then this is the plan here. So this is the stage house door. That's the bottom of the fire escape. And Main Street is out here. So South Street is right here. And the sidewalk is right along here. And they just repaved this whole area back here as a part of the Pulaski Park project. So we had about 30 inches of height to get it. To create a ramp to get into this door, and we felt like this was about the only place we could put a ramp. We couldn't do it on the Pulaski Park side. It just wasn't physically enough room in the back or the parking to have to do anything. You can see this from the photograph, it's just a very, very tight site right there, so we had to squish it in. So the city came and they built this temporary stair there because the granite stair was falling apart, and they also have a lot of issues of ice from that upper roof of this building here sliding off and taking the gutters off and crashing down. So we wanted to come up with a better solution to protect the door and to get handicap accessibility into that building. So it's a relatively simple ramp. The desire was to not have to do too much concrete, to make it more kind of metal and industrial looking in keeping with the fire escape. This was kind of a modernization of the old fire escape. If you remember, it had all these flat straps that crisscrossed on it, but this was a little more modern version of that. So our new ramp would be from here to here. The metal bar grating that you'd walk on, and then metal vertical pickets sitting on top of a steel C channel. So that's from here to here. There's a ramp, a flat area, and a little stair. And then from here to here, where it gets really close to the grade, we were thinking we would do a low concrete wall and then just bring asphalt pavers up to here, so it was more kind of integrated into the grade, not as prominent. But we had to have railings all the way up.
The landing area outside the door,
mm-hmm.
is that the metal grating also?
Yes.
Okay.
It has a roof over it, and the reason we're using the metal grating is so they wouldn't have to shuffle it as much.
I see.
Yeah.
What are the roofs on the original building? Are those standing seams?
Yeah, this is standing seam.
Right.
Yeah.
I know. So are you matching the color of that on the that?
Yeah.
That chin.
Yeah. And then there was slate on the upper roof, and then some upper roof, and some asphalt. So it's like every kind of roof you can think of. I know you had an early question about our door width not being 36 inches, and it was just accidentally drawn wrong.
Okay.
I'd measured the masonry opening, and then we just stuck a door in there, so.
Is there a reason of making the roof a little bit wider to cover the whole landing? It looks like it's short of the landing.
It is. I was, you know, just trying to not make it too prominent on that side there. It could be bigger if you thought that was more appropriate.
Yeah, I'm just wondering, you don't want it to look too puny either.
Right.
I mean,
that's true.
That's substance over, you know, the large room is above it. But
yeah.
Are there any exterior lights on? At the door?
No, we don't have anything in there now. I think is there a light next to that door back
emergency
there now?
Light.
No, the side light, no. There's only interior.
Oh, okay. So we don't have any lights.
Okay.
We can put a light in there.
Is that a code requirement and an egress?
It is, yeah.
Light.
But it's an existing egress, so.
It might just be a nice thing to have.
That's true.
You talked up on the roof there.
Yeah,
yeah,
performers going.
Put something on the underside of that roof, that's a good idea. Yeah. Right now, there's really actually no money in the city's budget to build this.
To build this yet? We're just getting ready.
Yeah, so. We have a plan in place and there's some money, but yes, we could add a light there.
GoFundMe.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, another unresolved question for me was, you know, we've got this ramp that's sitting up on metal posts there. And I don't know whether we want to take the ground underneath that ramp and pave it in asphalt, put out fine stone dust or try to get some kind of ground cover to work there, but no matter what, it's going to gather trash.
Yeah. So. Probably a hard surface would be better just so it can be cleaned out easier.
Yeah.
You know, if it's some sort of ground cover, it's just going to get more filled with stuff.
I hate to see more, even more asphalt along there, so.
When you're saying asphalt, you really mean asphalt, because we don't allow for sidewalks. They have to be concrete, semi-concrete.
Right,
so.
This is just under the ramp, so it's just in this little spot right there.
Right, but still, I think it should be concrete to match, I mean, so there's a continuous sort of visual
mm-hmm.
of concrete that's separate
yeah.
from the street. I was going to ask you the same thing about that ramp with asphalt pavers. That doesn't seem consistent with the plaza, the cement concrete.
Yeah, except right now the... that is blacktopped. They just blacktopped that area right at the rear.
Yeah, there's
the
a
there,
this
the,
is,
that's
this
all
is
new
asphalt
blacktop
right,
right
there.
There.
And then the pavers are over here.
Right. So the pavers that you just showed, what's that material? Is it composite cement?
It's
cement
a
paver?
Hexagonal asphalt paver.
Oh, they're asphalt.
Yeah, they look like that. Smith College uses them all around the campus.
So that was the intent for that, the same pavers to be used on the rampart?
Well, no. We're going to go with an asphalt paver here on an asphalt bed with sand on top because it was a little less expensive. But I know there's a desire to just make it asphalt and not do pavers to save money.
Okay.
I think that would be an issue.
Well, I think it should match what, you know, if they just finish that area. I don't think it should be matching the parking, because you want a distinction between the parked area and the pedestrian area.
Yeah.
And everything in downtown is cement, concrete.
Mm-hmm.
But to the extent that there are those other pavers elsewhere in that sort of plaza area,
uh-huh.
You could, I suppose it would make sense to match what's there, as opposed to introduce a new asphalt material.
We could, yeah. I don't know what the cost of those are, but we could look at that, yeah. Sure. Okay. But in terms of what happens underneath this here, the reason I was thinking of maybe fine stone dust is it just wouldn't look so like a sea of pavement, and you could rake it and clean it.
It'd certainly be less expensive.
Right.
Well, yeah. Or even, what about just pavers, like, you know, sand
well,
pavers?
I know they don't want the money for that.
Really?
I'm sure. Yes. Let's see. Just hit somebody hard.
You know, I just want to go back to addressing that roof thing again.
Yeah.
The only reason I was thinking about that is that if you notice, everyone hangs out at that door during a show, and people are always hanging out. When you have a landing, people are going to be standing on it. So
that's true.
A few people are going to be getting soaked. You know, I mean, just over the whole landing, you might make it
larger.
I think especially if somebody's in a wheelchair, too, it's going to be something. You know, getting up
have
there.
Have a little more space.
Yeah, just with, mm-hmm. with somebody standing
sure.
by some, you know, is pushing it or.
So
no, I don't think it would overwhelm the like, side of the building. I don't think it would just to go that far and make that roof look too big
like
that. You know.
Half again this large. Take half of that and add it over here or something, about 3 feet or something. Yeah, we could do that.
Because as soon as we approve this, it just gets shelved until this point.
Correct.
Tom, can I just address that issue for a second? I'm Dave Palmer, Inspector of Central Services. So
yeah.
we oversee the building,
right.
And we would basically deal with the procurement, bidding, and construction management of the ramp system. So we're already talking about submitting this under the capital program from this coming fall. So that would mean if it gets funded, we'd be in the ground probably next May or June. And because of the importance of this for handicap accessibility for the stage area, I was certainly lobbying it when I presented to the capital committee that it should receive funding. So I'm not printing the money in the basement memorial,
no.
But I think we can definitely push for it.
No, I believe we need it. You know, it's just a shame. I mean, there's been so much nice work done to the academy, and now we got that pressure-treated stair sitting out there on South Street, you know? I mean, I would look forward to this getting done sooner than later, you know? But do you have a resistance to making that roof a little larger on financial reasons at all?
No.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's that much of an expense to enlarge that.
No.
Just like 3 or 4 feet longer.
Right.
I think it would be really important also to look at that beginning part of the ramp being concrete, like Carolyn was saying. It's this is a important building in downtown Northampton, and it is a visible, even though it's a side elevation, it's a very visible location right up against the street, and it gets a lot of use. I think concrete would be a better material.
Okay.
Should be considered as at least priced out as an option.
You're talking the area underneath
the area, both the area, well, first the beginning part of the ramp that was going to be the asphalt pavers, or matching the pavers that are already in the rear courtyard area, but something that's more permanent than.
But I do like that those hexagonal asphalt pavers are really nice. Nice pattern, and we just use them for a ramp in front of the Arts Trust at the entry.
So would you have a concrete berm on either side
yeah.
of it?
Yeah, the wall would come up and then the pavers would be between it.
Okay. What color would you use?
Well, they
The one I like is kind of a grayish black, and then it's got this exposed aggregate in it that's granite, like a bluish granite.
So it'll have a definite color differentiation from the asphalt.
Yeah, and then you really do see the hexagon pattern. It's a nice pattern. It's kind of fine texture.
Yeah, can we see your board a little bit closer?
Yeah. I should have brought a sample of asphalt paper.
And then you like this one? Or?
Yeah, it was one of these two. I can't remember.
That's what you said. That's what they used in front of the alumni house, too?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, there's a handicap ramp that goes up. I mean, it's imperceptible ramp because it's so flat, but we used it there. And it goes up to a granite from patio. It just kind of, it's nice, it differentiates the walking surface from the regular old sidewalk and makes it a little more special in the pattern. It's nice.
Coming right off the park.
I can bring some pictures or a sample if you'd like. I'd be more than happy to do that.
I mean, one of the things you could say is just not regular bituminous, not a white asphalt.
Yeah.
Right.
I think the other piece that concerns me about this is like you said, is just trash gathering underneath the ramp. And is there any, I don't know that there is any way to avoid that. If you put screening up there, then you can't get to it to get it out.
I know. And this is the far more affordable way of building it rather than building a big long concrete wall along there.
Yeah, which is just too monolithic and heavy for the look of that.
And then somebody would want it brick faced.
It historically matching brick and mortar.
Yes. I mean, it would be nice if we could get some kind of ground cover to grow, but the stone dust might be nice if you can make it out. That's your job, right?
This is Addy. He's the front of house manager.
Right, the theater manager. Addy, hi.
So, would you be averse to stone dust?
No, I think stone dust is a good idea because you can always put more down. It's an inexpensive material, but it does compact pretty hard. And it's a lighter material. It's not like dark asphalt. Yeah. It's a nice light gray color. I prefer to see that than asphalt.
And it gives the option in the future to always be changed.
Right.
This is something else. There's more money in the future. Or you need an improvement. So.
Yeah.
I agree with that. So do we feel like we want to make a motion to approve it with conditions?
Up to you. It sounds like the condition would be to have the roof overhang the entire landing area, and stone dust under the ramp, and then something that's decorative asphalt paper or something.
Well, that's already called out on the plans.
The roof overhang not to go over
the landing. No. The hexagonal pavers. Oh, okay. We don't have to include that.
Right. So, well, then it was just
we're accepting it.
Okay. That's fine. Yeah. As long as it's on the plan and you're accepting it, that's fine. But the stone dust underneath, is that on the plan?
No.
Okay. Yeah. So maybe that is just the roof overhang and the stone dust.
Someone make a motion.
And I just want to be clear, but your intent is on the new roof to match the standing steel. That will match the other roof. The upper roofs.
Yes.
Okay. I'll attempt a motion. Correct me if necessary.
You can make a single motion of closing and issuing. Because you have to officially close the public hearing.
Oh. I have a motion to close the public hearing. Are there any other public comments? Okay. We'll close the public hearing and get a motion.
So I make a motion to accept the presentation with the exception of enlarging the shed roof over the landing of the entrance to the width of the landing, and that the material to be used underneath the ramp would be a stone dust.
Okay.
And that's obviously with, let me finish it, that's it.
Do you want to mention something about a light? Or was that just a suggestion?
Yeah, we'll put a light under the canopy, that's fine.
As long as it's not visible, you don't need to look at that.
And the addition of an egress light under the landing roof. I mean, you're sort of returning, so that's a motion we can vote on, I just have a quick question, just like, the curb remains, right, to retain the stone dust? Or does the stone dust go down to the level of the sidewalk?
The curb would remain.
Yeah, I think that's important, just to retain it, you know?
Yeah, so we'll scrape the dirt off there, build the ramp, and then put in stone dust.
Yeah.
Build that whole area.
So that's a motion.
Can I get a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Okay.
All in favor, thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you.
We know you always do good work, so we're not too critical of you.
Those are all good suggestions.
The whole thing is, yeah, it's all nice looking, you know, it's really coming around, you know? Yeah, as well as the park being finished behind there, just.
I know.
The whole end of town is just.
Yeah, the park is a great addition to the city.
I did some.
You got the little.
Yeah, you stuck.
You did.
I don't have like pocket park, though.
Oh, yeah.
Are you working on it?
No. Just like it, I like that idea.
We're gonna just move on to some internal business.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We have two sets of meeting minutes to approve, from June 6th and from July 11th. These were sent out by Carolyn via email. Has everyone had a chance to read them?
I have two looking.
Can I get a motion to approve the minutes for both June 6th and July 11th, unless anyone has any comments or corrections?
Your turn.
Can I?
Make a motion.
Something that, if I wasn't there at the meeting?
You can accept them into the record, that's what you're basically doing.
Okay.
Okay.
Motion.
Motion to approve the minutes?
Yes.
For both June 6th and July 11th. Okay, I guess.
All set.
All in favor? Is there any other business?
No, I mean, I thought that was enough for.
Okay.
In the summer.
Can I get a motion to close the meeting, please?
I'll make a motion to close the meeting.
I'll second it.
All in favor?